You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good morning for me, good afternoon, probably most likely good evening for you when you're watching this. Welcome back. I want to start with some administrivia, just to kind of catch you up. One of the things that I want to make sure you understand is that the grades for the first reaction paper have been published, meaning if you look up your grades on Blackboard, you'll see your grade, you'll see your score out of 20. You'll also see comments if you lost points, or even if you didn't lose points, we tried to put a positive comment like excellent job, good work, fine job, whatever, just to give you positive reinforcement so you'll feel wonderful about the next assignment. If you have a problem with your grade, please first read the comments and then email either George or myself, and we'll be happy to talk to you about it. We've already talked to a few people about it electronically. Happy to meet you in my lab and talk about it. Just let me know what your issue is and we'll take care of it from there. I do want to also point out that please don't panic. This was the very first assignment. There are 1,000 points in this class and this assignment was worth 20 points. If you didn't get a good grade, there's extra credit up there right now that can get you up to 8 points. That can raise your grade from basically a C up to an A. And I also want to remind you, even though I sent this out in an announcement, that my grading scale is a little different. 90% is an A, that's normal. 75% is a B, that's not so normal. 60% is a C, that's really not normal. And 50% is a D, that's totally abnormal. The reason I do that is because I have high expectations for you. And so I make my assignments, as you now can tell, such that they make you think a lot. I do my exams such that they make you think a lot. And so in general, the scores are a little lower in my class. In fact, usually the average score in my class is in the 65% range, 67-68% range, which would be a D in a normal class, but because 60% is a C in my class, it's a C. I thoroughly respect that sometimes my tests are harder and that my assignments take some thinking and make you work harder. So I apologize in advance for making you think. It's my job. So a couple of other administrative things. The second reaction paper will be coming out very soon. I'm working on refining it. I want to discuss it a little bit now so that you're aware of what it's going to be. The second reaction paper is actually going to be pretty easy for you. I fully expect that everybody's going to end up getting a perfect score on it if they follow the instructions. So what you're going to do for the second reaction paper is you're going to start collecting data about your smartphone usage. There will be 3 different ways to collect data depending upon your preference and your type of smartphone. If you're interested in using an app to collect the data in the background so you don't have to do any work, I will be sending out instructions on how to use an app. Unfortunately, it's not the same app for iPhones as it is for Android-based phones. It should be. It's sad that it's not. Been talking to the company about making it such that it works for both. They're a little slow. But if you're an iPhone user and you want to use an app to collect these data, and all it's going to collect, the only thing that we're going to care about is how many times each day you unlock your phone, meaning you use a code or a fingerprint to open your phone, and how many minutes you spend on that phone, and that's an app called Moment. And I'll be sending you complete instructions on how to use this with pretty color pictures that show you what you should see on your phone, hopefully. And also I'll be available to help anybody because I use Moment on my phone. If you use an Android-based phone, then there's a program, an app called Instant Quantified Self, and you will install that if you want. If you're opposed to using an app on your phone, or if you don't have an Android-based phone and you don't have an iPhone, you can also just keep a diary, a daily diary, where you keep track of how many times you unlock your phone and how many minutes it stays unlocked. And I'm going to send you directions on how to do that too, including a sample spreadsheet of how you keep the data. The really important thing here is that, and I'll stress this when I send out the assignment also, that you install the app or start your diary ASAP, because on March 7th, or before March 7th, you're going to send your data in as part of an assignment. Basically, the assignment's going to consist of two things. One, sending your data, and there's explicit instructions on how to do that. And the second part is answering three really short questions about your data. They're not rocket science. They're very easy. One's going to ask you to calculate your average number of times you unlock your phone each day and the average number of minutes. And then one's going to ask you to comment on whether it's the same as you expected, less than you expected, or more than you expected. And then the third question I'm going to leave for later, you'll be able to see it, but it's going to ask your opinion about your use of the phone. So it's all easy to do. I fully expect that everybody should get a 20 out of 20. Speaking of 20 out of 20, on the first reaction paper, people in general did very well. I was very pleased to see that we only had 22 people enrolled in the class who did not turn one in. That's fantastic. There are 401 people officially enrolled in this class. So only to have 22 people not turn one in is very impressive. That's better than I expected. It's better than the normal class when I teach it live. So that's great. The other thing that was very pleasantly surprising to both George and myself was that the average score was just shy of 18, 17.7, something like that, I think. 18 is 90%, which is an A. So the average score was basically almost an A. And then as a caveat, I will say that there were some low scores. And the low scores were very apparent as to why they were low scores, because people didn't read instructions. And in general, people missed out on one of two different things. Either part two of the assignment, where you were supposed to pick one question from each of the five groupings of questions and then go and remind us how you answered each of the questions there, and then answer why you answered them that way. A lot of people either just picked one question out of a set. So they picked, say, question two, but then they only addressed one of the items on question two. Question two had, I think, five or six items in it, and you were supposed to address all of them. Some people did not put the why. They didn't explain why they did it. They just said, I answered this, I answered this, I answered this, without telling me the why. That got you reduced score. A lot of people skipped question three and question four on the assignment. Question three asked, was a more generic, general question of what drives your tech behavior, what makes you do what you do. A lot of people just skipped that. Some people, interestingly enough, integrated that into each of the questions, which was fine with me, as long as they said, this is what drives my behavior. And then question four was, what's your relationship to your smartphone, and do you feel that it interferes with your life in any ways or not? And for some reason, I mean, not a lot of people, but people tended to get through those questions in part two and then just skip the rest and move on ahead. So again, I want to remind you, it's only 20 points out of 1,000. That's a very small amount. There's enough extra credit to cover any deficit you have, and it's a good learning experience. And again, if you have any questions whatsoever about it, please let me know. You can email me. So what I want to do today is to finish up the PowerPoint that I was working on last time we talked, and then I'm going to start talking today about memory and the brain and how it works, and this will last through today's lecture and undoubtedly through Thursday's. I promise to have the study guide out no later than Thursday. I'm working on it. It'll come out. It'll come out as an announcement that's emailed to everybody. Please pay attention to your email. One of the things I noticed, by the way, which was kind of a side benefit, as I was reading the papers, I noticed that when people talked about checking email, which was one of the questions, I think question two or something like that, how often do you check email on your phone? A lot of people mentioned that they check their campus email, but I was surprised to see that a lot of people said they check their campus email every couple days. Not a good idea in this class. You need to be checking your campus email every day. In fact, I recommend you check it in the morning, and I recommend you check it at night, because I use announcements and email a lot, and you really do need to stay up on top of things. And a lot of the mistakes people made were just not paying attention to what I wrote by email or what I made it as an announcement. So it's just a word to the wise. So let's go back. And if you remember, we were talking about James Marcia's identity status model. And I mentioned that it required two things. One, a crisis or crises, and two, commitment to something. And I talked about the four different kinds of identity: identity diffusion, foreclosure, moratorium, and identity achievement. This is all review. What I didn't have, got thrown off the slide somehow, was this slide, which I think is very interesting. Basically, these are the only data I've ever seen using Marcia's model. Marcia's model is fairly popular, but it doesn't get studied very much because it's pretty straightforward. If you go and look down the left-hand side, you'll see age level: pre-high school, high school freshmen and sophomores, juniors and seniors, college freshmen and sophomores, college juniors and seniors. And you see starting from the left to the right, the left is identity achievement, the next one is moratorium, foreclosure, and identity diffusion. Identity achievement is the goal. Identity achievement is the positive goal. It's where you want to be. And this research shows, if you look back at the slide, you'll see that starting in high school, there's very few kids pre-high school who are in identity achievement. And as kids get older and older and into college and junior and senior, they get more identity achievement. But interestingly enough, by the time students are juniors and seniors, still only 4 out of 10 have achieved their identity, know what they want to do with their life. You can see for pre-high school, they're mostly in identity diffusion, and you can go back and look at what that means. But basically, it's they haven't had any crisis, they haven't committed to anything, a lot in foreclosure. And you can just follow along and see that as students grow in age, they change from being identity diffusion less and less. Foreclosure sort of stays the same. Moratorium stays the same. But what really increases is identity achievement, which is where you want to be going. So I wanted to be able to do that. I want to talk about another idea about identity. And this is Sherry Turkle. I believe I've mentioned Sherry Turkle before, but Sherry Turkle is a very interesting person. If we can come back to me, I want to talk a little bit about her. I have a question here from Jackie. How many extra credit assignments will there be also for the same points? I have no earthly clue, Jackie. I promise you there will be extra credit assignments. It matters whether students ask me if they can use our class for extra credit. The students who are working on the fake news project asked me if they could use our class. There will be other students who will ask. I will do my best to get you as much extra credit as I can. But thank you for your question. Sherry Turkle is an emeritus professor like I am, meaning you're sort of retired, but you're still working. Doesn't mean you're any smarter. It just means you're older, usually. Sherry Turkle started studying this way back, right around the same time I started studying this area of the impact of technology. She's at MIT in the Media Lab. She's actually sort of an interesting conglomerate. She's a psychoanalyst trained in France, and she's also a cultural anthropologist and a psychologist, a research psychologist, sort of all by training. She has written many books. Her latest is called Alone Together, which talks about how people are all spending all their time online and on their phones. And even though they're together, they're still alone. And she talks a lot about what it's doing to relationships. And we'll talk more about that later on. Probably one of the smartest things I think Sherry ever said was that what we get online is just what she calls sips of connection rather than communication. So we just get little bits of connection with people, a text here, an email here, a quick blurb here, a post on Facebook, a snap, whatever. Those are little sips of connection and not true communication. And if you go back to the communication lecture, you'll see all of what goes into communication. And Sherry would say we're missing a lot of that. Sherry Turkle has written a lot of books. I should say slyly, almost as many as I have. And I think her one of the books that I think is important is the one here on the screen called, strangely enough, Life on the Screen. This was very early where she was looking at how you portrayed yourself online. This was written back in the 80s, I believe, maybe the early 90s. And she made a very interesting distinction, and I think if you're studying for the test, this is probably a great test question, between what she called RL and SL. RL was real life, that's you in the real world. SL was screen life, that's you on the screen. And this whole book is really about how people portray themselves on the screen. As a cultural anthropologist, what she did is interviewed a lot of people who were gamers and looked at their attitudes, the way they portrayed themselves, their putting on this rubric of identity, their self-identity in screen life, in SL, and she compared that to their identity in real life and found that there were some striking differences, that people on the screen were very different than people in real life, which is, again, a theme of this course we've been talking about life behind the screen. So I would ask you then, how does technology play a role in this whole process? Certainly social networks, social media does. You portray your identity through a lot of ways in your pages. The music you like, what you click like to, what you don't like, conversations you have, posts that you have, friends that you have, photos, all of these portray your identity. And that's the most common way of us portraying our identity is through social media. But we also portray social identity through our phones. We customize our ringtones. I have a custom ringtone for my kids. I also have a custom ringtone for my mother, so I know when not to answer the phone. Unless I want the gastrointestinal report for the day and then I have to answer the phone. Even the cover you use for your phone. Sparkly covers show something different than plain covers. My phone, which is over here, is just a plain cover. I've seen lots of people with really sparkly covers with all sorts of fancy stuff on it with different colors. I had once had a phone cover that I could change the corners of to different colors all the time, and sort of my mood, depending upon my mood that day, I used purple or black if I was in a bad mood, or pink if I was in a good mood. I don't know why. So the question then you want to ask is, am I my technology? Am I defined through my use of technology? And that's one way of looking at it. Another way is through selfies, because selfies are an expression of your identity. There are millions of selfies. One-third of all pictures by what you might call millennials or early millennials are selfies. Half of millennials basically post selfies, and college students and certainly male college students and female college students. And the prediction is that people will post approximately one selfie per day over their lifetime, or 25,700 selfies. So let's go to slightly a different topic for a few minutes. Since we're talking about health, let's talk about video games' effect on health. This is a study that I think was, I had to pick and choose through studies, and we're going to talk about this later on again anyway. But I wanted to pick this study as a way of demonstrating to you how video games affect emotions and mental health issues. So this was a study where they looked at people playing three different kinds of games, massive multiplayer online role-playing games, MMORPGs. I have a son who plays a lot of role-playing games. That's his thing. First-person shooters, or what they call online ego shooter games, OES. You'll need these abbreviations, but I'm repeating them on everything. And then real-time strategy games, are very different. And they did an anonymous survey through online forums that talked about these kind of games, and they got a pretty decent sample size. And what they were looking at is problematic internet usage. And problematic internet usage, PIU, is a very important topic. People talk about addiction, and we've talked about internet addiction, but primarily what they're really talking about is problematic internet usage. Hasn't reached the level of all of the characteristics that I told you go into internet addiction, but it's still a problematic usage, and they talk a lot about problematic gaming behavior defined by these five characteristics. Loss of control, meaning you can't control your behavior anymore. It leads to social problems offline, that you don't react well with other people, you don't deal well with other people. You get withdrawal, meaning if you haven't played in a certain amount of time, you start getting an itch to play. You build up a tolerance where you have to play more and more to get the same sort of satisfaction. And we'll talk later today or on Thursday about what that's like biochemically. And then just major impairments in your daily life, your family life, your work life. All of these are issues in problematic gaming behavior, which will probably be in the new DSM-6, the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual. The DSM-5 has depressive symptoms. These are all the symptoms of depression. You can read those at your leisure. But this study looked at video gaming, and first of all, what it did is it looked at how much the average gamer played. And you can see on the bottom, this is hours of playing video games and the percentage of gamers playing them. And the average worked out to nearly 6 hours a day, the average gamer. And remember, they did this in areas where only gamers would be taking this survey. So when you look at the different kinds of games, this is two separate graphs. One is problematic gaming behaviors and one is depressive tendencies. And on the bottom are the three different kinds of gaming activities. The massive role-playing games, the first-person ego shooters, and real-time strategy games from left to right. So you can see that those people who played the massive multiplayer online role-playing games, I just call them RPGs, role-playing games, showed the most problematic gaming behaviors and the most depressive tendencies. So those are the ones you have to worry about most, although the other two were pretty close in comparison. But again, more playing of massive multiplayer online role-playing games led to more problematic gaming behaviors and more depressive tendencies. They also measured escapism and time spent continuously in the game. And you can see, again, these kind of games, the role-playing games, keep them continuously almost 6.5, a little more than 6.5 hours of time, as opposed to 5.5 hours for the other kind of games. That's still a lot of game playing. And in terms of escapism, there's a small effect showing that those who play role-playing games are more escapist. So basically, those players who play role-playing games showed more problematic gaming behaviors and more escapisms. They had more chance of depressions, and probably because of spending more time doing it. Another study on psychological impacts was done, and this is done by Jean Twenge, who looks at large databases. I believe we've talked about her before. She looks at large databases that collect lots and lots of information. And this one is hours per day of use of technology. I caution you that this is a conglomerate of all kinds of screen media. And that means it's adding up all your smartphone time, it's adding up all your tablet time, it's adding up all your TV time. It's just an amount of time. It doesn't say what you're doing. I noticed a lot of people when they talked about on their reaction papers. If we can come back to me, I want to talk about this for a second. A lot of people on the reaction papers talked about what they did on their time, and if you have iPhone with screen time, you'll see that screen time breaks it up into productivity time, entertainment time, gaming time, time with different apps, and you see that time is not time. So I have a little bit of trouble with data where it's just total time, but this is such an interesting study that let's go back to the screen. And if you look, If you play no hour, if you use no technology, basically, and you're an adolescent, this is your sense of low well-being, meaning these people over here are more psychologically impacted negatively. As screen time increases from basically from a half hour a day up to a massive amount of 7 or more hours a day, both of these surveys, one from the US and one from the UK, show that there's an increase in what I would call ill-being or poor mental health. The interesting thing is that playing a little bit is the most helpful. Playing a half hour a day or being on your phone a half hour a day or using your technology a half hour a day or whatever you do is the most healthy. Actually doing nothing is more unhealthy. So I thought that was interesting. A couple other psychological impacts. This is a study that just came out, and I'm just going to read you what it says. What it did is looked at depressive symptoms and social networking sites, and it did what's called a meta-analysis. A meta-analysis is where you take research that's been done by many different people and published in many different places, and you combine all of those studies together to draw one global conclusion. So you can see here, if you're reading this, based on 55 independent samples totaled up of about 80,000 people, they found an effect size of 0.165. What the hell does that mean? Well, effect sizes tell you how strong the relationship is, and 0.165, you don't need to know these things, but it's a small positive association between self-reported symptoms of depression and social media, social network use. Meaning those people who use social media more often or for longer time, depending upon how each of these different studies measured it differently, showed more symptoms of depression. Here's another one that just came out by Andrew Przybylski in the UK. And basically what he did is looked at a large data set of 355,000 people, adolescents, and concludes that the association we find between digital technology use and adolescent well-being is negative but small. So he's finding the same kind of results. And then another one that just came out also basically found moderately strong evidence between screen time and obesity, higher depressive symptoms, and energy intake, less healthy diet, poor quality of life. And then finally, again from Jean Twenge, she's taken data that looks across time and finds that screen time shows more screen time basically shows more depressive symptoms and more suicidal ideation and more suicide. And then you can see these are just, again, more of the public making comments. These are all from, this from USA Today, this is from The Atlantic, this is from Time Magazine, and this is their take on what it is. And you have to be careful when you read the media because their take on it is different than reality. So there are a couple theories I want to talk about here. One is called uses and gratification theory, and I'm going to talk about this much more later today and this week. But basically, uses and gratification theory is that we do things, we use things, we use technology for certain gratifications, for certain good feelings, what we get out of it. We get entertainment, we get satisfaction, we get pride, we get positive feelings. So it explains why we might use certain things. I think it's less important than social capital theory, which is really important. Social capital theory talks about the fact that we create social capital, meaning people. That we have people in our lives that give us, and capital means money, but we're really not getting money from them, we're getting good things from them. And we have three kinds of social capital. We have, probably our most important is called bonding social capital, that's the first one on the screen. And that really talks about your closest friends. Oftentimes this is referred to as your core ties. It's your family, these are people you go to with problems, this is your best friend, this is your spouse. Whoever, this is a small group of people that you gain social capital from, social money, social good feelings. The second one is maintaining social capital, and this is sort of old friends. I always describe this as my friends from high school, my friends from college, people I've known for a long time. I don't see them much. I don't consider them core ties. They're not necessarily that close, but if I have a problem, I can go talk to them about it. And so this is kind of constant social capital that's available for my use. You can think of it as in the middle are our core ties, our bonding social capital, then around that is our maintaining, and then around that is what's called our bridging social capital, which are basically all of our acquaintances. As human beings, we try to collect social capital. And more time on Facebook ends up meaning that we have more bridging social capital, which is just acquaintances. So there are some positive things you can do, and these are talked about in the book extensively, so I'm not going to go over them much, but there's something called the quantified self movement, which is using tracking devices like Fitbits or Apple Watches or sleep monitors to track your health. I would classify Apple's screen time and Google's digital well-being apps as helping you quantify what you do. Quantify means give a number to. There's also different kind of games that provide you fitness. Dance Dance Revolution was one of the first ones. I remember when my kids got that and they did this dancing thing where they followed the screen and they did steps and tried, I can't remember, something about arrows and trying to get arrows before they went off the screen. I don't know, I was just flabbergasted watching them and how impressed I was. Then there's Wii games, which keep you up and active. A lot of the video games keep you up and active. Pokemon Go, I encourage you to read the beginning, I think, of chapter 9, I believe, that talks about Pokemon Go and as the case study for chapter 9 and the impact it had on fitness. And then there's emotional fitness, online communities, going to talk to people. We'll talk more and more about that this semester. Virtual empathy, which we've talked about, just taking time off. And now what I want to do is shift gears, and here we go. So we're going to be talking about this now for the rest of today and for the rest of Thursday, and hopefully I will get through everything because it's important. So what I'm going to talk about are models of memory. And in order to talk about models of memory, I have to talk about processing, how we process information. So the first model we're going to talk about is called the Atkinson-Shiffrin model of memory. This is from 1968, and believe it or not, people still adhere to this model, people still believe it, because it makes intuitive sense. It's probably not the most accurate model, but it makes intuitive sense. So what Atkinson and Shiffrin did is they said information enters into what's called the sensory information store through auditory channels, visual channels, and other sensory information, taste, smell, etc. In the sensory information store, they stay very briefly, and either they're lost due to lack of attention, or they get attended to and move over into what's called short-term memory. I think most of you have probably heard of the phrase short-term memory. Short-term memory is a small holding place, basically, for information. Information in there lasts about 15 to 30 seconds, depending upon how much attention you pay to it. Attention turns out to be really important. If you focus on something and attend to it, then it gets processed in all of these models and gets either moved up or stored someplace or saved for later use. Short-term memory is just a holding place. It's considered to contain what's called 7 ± 2 chunks of information. What does that mean? 7 + 2 is 9, 7 - 2 is 5. So between 5 and 9 chunks of information. What is a chunk of information? Chunk of information can be an item. A spoon is a chunk of information. A chunk of information can be a fork, spoon, and a knife. That could be one chunk of information. Of utensils for a meal. I often like to phrase this in terms of numbers. If I read you a series of numbers, just randomly, I just started reading you a series of numbers, 1, 7, 3, 2, 4, 5, 9, 0, 1, 2, 4, 7, 3, and then asked you to repeat them back, I guarantee you that, and repeat them back in order, I guarantee you that you'll get somewhere between 5 and 9. However, if I read you a list that went 213-323-714-858, anybody recognize what those are? Those are area codes. And so 213 is not the number 2, the number 1, and the number 3. It's not three chunks of information, it's one. 213 is the area code for much of the phone numbers in Los Angeles, I guess, still. So is 323, and 714 is Orange County, and 858 is San Diego. You get the idea, right? So if the material in short-term memory is rehearsed or not rehearsed, that tells what happens to it. So first of all, if it's not rehearsed, then it's lost due to what's called forgetting. If it is rehearsed, sorry about this missing E here, it's encoded and goes into what's called long-term memory. What is long-term memory? Well, most models of memory, just like the Atkinson-Shiffrin model, think of long-term memory as stuff that's there forever. And also stuff that stays there and is retrievable if you can figure out how to find it. So if you think of somebody who's young and little and learning material, they can tell you stories about things that happened to them last week, last month, last year, because they don't have very much information in their long-term memory store yet. If you talk to me and ask me what I had for breakfast yesterday, I probably can't remember because I have so much junk stuck in my long-term memory that sometimes it's hard to find it. And so there's interference. This box for long-term memory should basically be a wall-less box because long-term memory is considered to be infinite. It includes information, definitions. It includes episodes, things that happen to you. Some people talk about including something called flashbulb memories, where you are in a situation and you take a flash camera picture of something, and that's ingrained. I'll talk to you a little bit later about whether that's really true or not, whether we really have pictures in our brains. It can keep sounds. Everybody can identify the sound of a creaking door opening. They know exactly what it is, so that your long-term memory has to have sounds. And then there's this issue of recall versus recognition. Big area in studying memory, and that is that if I ask you to say, recall what Marcia's model talks about in terms of identity achievement, could you do it? My guess is not. If I gave you a list of what things are in identity achievement and said, which phase of Marcia's model is this, could you recognize the phase? And of course the answer is yes, you could. So recognition is always better than recall. That's why students really like multiple choice tests, because that's a recognition test, as opposed to essay tests, which is a recall test. Very different. Recall is much harder. That's why I don't give you essay tests. Do we forget? Nope. We never forget anything. We just can't find it. So this is one of the earliest studies in 1960 looking at our memory for, in this case, letters. And I'm just going to briefly tell you how George Sperling did this study. What he did is he showed a sequence of letters for 50 milliseconds, that's 5/100ths of a second. That is so brief, it's subliminal. Ordinarily, if I do this in a class, I would do this and wipe the out. So let's see if I can simulate it. So how many of those letters did you get? I'll do it again. So what George Sperling showed is that if he showed this matrix like this of 12 letters, and showed them to you, that you could get about 3 or 4 of them, basically, because it was so fast, you could see the imprint on your audit, on your visual cortex of about 3 or 4 of them, usually 4. But then what he'd do is he'd train you. And so he'd train you that if he played a high tone, beep, that you were supposed to only focus on the top row. If you played a middle tone, beep, you're only to focus on the middle row. If he played you a low tone, beep. Is that low enough? Beep. You're only to focus on the lowest row. So what we would do is he would show you this matrix really quickly for 5/100ths of a second, and then he would immediately play the tone. And what he found is that regardless of which tone he played, you could get those four letters, which meant that you had an imprint in your brain of all 12 of them. It's just that when you try to name them, the others disappear. The act of naming them makes the others disappear from you. So he showed that sensory memory, this visual memory, is very transitory. It disappears pretty quickly. Interestingly enough, if he delayed the tone, if he played the tone immediately, you could get actually basically 9 letters. If he delayed the tone even just 7/10ths of a second, you're back down to your 4 letters. So bottom line is that tone has to be immediate or the visual image just disappears off your brain and goes away. The second box in the Atkinson-Shiffrin model is the short-term memory box. And the classic study in order to understand how short-term memory works was by Peterson and Peterson. This is in the 70s, husband and wife team. And what they would do is they would either visually or auditorily, mostly auditorily, they would read you a list of letters. These were called nonsense syllables. So there were 3 letters that you couldn't put together as any kind of a word. They're just 3 random nonsense letters together. Then what you'd do is hear a random number, like 539, and they'd make you count backwards from 539 by sevens. Really a really fun task, right? So they might show you the letters EVQ and then say 632. And then you'd have to go 632 minus 7 is 625. 618, 611. And at the meantime, then he would stop you from counting backwards after a certain amount of time and flash a light and try ask you to remember what the letters were. This is how long you counted backwards for. This is the percent correct, your chance of getting it correct. If you don't count backwards at all, you get 100% chance of getting it correct. But by the time you count backwards, really about 7 or 8 seconds here, you're down to 0. What is happening? Well, the idea is that counting backwards by sevens is a very difficult task, and it's a short-term memory task. And remember, the short-term memory holds only 5 to 9 chunks of information. If you're flooding it with numbers counting backwards, anything that's in your short-term memory is going to get shoved out. It's going to get pushed out. If you remember that model, if we don't rehearse the information in short-term memory, it just disappears, goes bye-bye. So we talked about this, that you can chunk things together, 213-714-323. The interesting thing is if I played you EVQ or spoke EVQ or even showed you EVQ and your job was to recall the E, you're more than likely to say G, which is a sound-alike, than you are to say F, which is a look-alike. So that's the idea that short-term memory is primarily auditory rather than visual. That it's not processing a bunch of visual information in there short-term, it's really a bunch of auditory information. And you know that because when you rehearse something, if I read you a bunch of numbers and asked you to do the bunch of numbers, you would be rehearsing them auditorily. You would be rehearsing them in your head by sound, not by looking at them in your mind's eye. So one of the things that they found is if they read a list of long words and told you that you were going to have to remember as many words as you can, that they came up with something called the serial position effect. So imagine that they read you 30 words and said, at the end of the 30 words, asked you to recall as many words as you can. You're much better at recalling a few words at the beginning of the list. That's because if the list started with knife, ball, toy, dog, What you're doing in your head is going knife, 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 knife. I can't even remember the second one. Was it ball? Knife, ball, knife, ball. But then more words are coming. So the primacy effect is you repeat it enough times that it gets into long-term memory, which actually means the next day you can remember it also. You'll also remember more at the end of the list because those are still in short-term memory. You're still repeating those in your short-term memory and rehearsing them. And so you end up with what's called a serial position effect, meaning you remember some at the beginning, a primacy at the beginning of the list, and some at the end of the list. Interestingly enough, if I make you delay, if I don't make you delay at the end, if I read you a list of words, in this study they read 15 words, and at the end of 15 words said, go, remember as many words as you can, you get this nice red serial position effect. You remember more from the beginning and more from the end. If, however, I end the list with the last word and then I make you do something for 30 seconds, you remember only the ones at the beginning of the list up here, and you don't remember the ones at the end very well because they've gone now out of short-term memory. Bye-bye, they're gone. Here's another example. This one's interesting. This is a serial position curve of 20 words where they can make you count backwards by sevens, and you can see that wipes out all of the recency effect, all of the short-term memory effect. So what is long-term memory? Long-term memory is considered to have sort of two aspects to it, and this is somewhat controversial. One aspect is called the declarative or the conscious part of your memory, and that's episodes, things that happen to you, facts, figures, knowledge. That's sort of declarative. They call it declarative knowledge or conscious knowledge. Then there's another part of long-term memory that's called implicit knowledge. It's not necessarily conscious. Not that it's unconscious, but it's not necessarily conscious. And this usually consists of two things. One are called priming effects, and the other is called procedural memory. Priming effects are when I might read you a long list of words. Say I read you a list of words, or 50 words, and those 50 words included some random words, some toys, some utensils, and then I said, what I want you to do is recall all the toys. You will be able to do that because I'm priming you to tell you that there were a bunch of toys in the list. Now go back in your brain, in your short-term memory, and try to get all those toys and lump them together into one big chunk. Or if I told you that there were a bunch of utensils in the list and I wanted you to recall the utensils, I'm priming you to recall certain things. By the way, this is really important for studying for tests. If you can prime yourself with certain words that will then bring up the whole concept, like for example, let's take Marcia's model. Could you think of studying about identity achievement, say, and then priming yourself with one specific word that might help you remember all about identity achievement, like a phrase like, I made it, or I know what I'm doing, or I got it, or something like that. That could prime you then to remember everything that you learned about identity achievement. Who has more of it, what it means, what people do with crises, how they make a commitment. So priming works that way in your brain, and really priming is a way of helping your brain locate information that's stored all over the place, because information is stored everywhere in your brain, even though I'm going to tell you about the main storage location. But priming helps you locate the information. And then procedural memory is that kind of memory of how to do things. We don't have to remember how to take a shower. We step into the shower, we know exactly the steps to take a shower. We don't have to remember, there's a great example in the book of going up and buying something through a drive-through restaurant. Nobody has to tell us every time we go to a drive-through restaurant how it works. We know you drive up, we know there's a speaker someplace, somebody says, can I take your order please, or something similar. We know that we then look at the list, we say, just a minute, let me decide, then we tell them what we want, then we drive up, then we pay, and then they give us our food, and we go happily and clog our arteries. So that's procedural memory. We have that. And what's interesting in our brains is if when you start the procedure, it's almost like it goes on its own. And a real good example of this would be taking a shower. Once you step into a shower, you no longer think about what you do. You just do things in pretty much the same order every time. Driving to campus. If you drive to campus the same way every day, then you don't think about driving to campus. You just drive to campus. It's almost like the inside of your brain is driving you rather than the outside world. My favorite is dealing cards. I love to play cards. And if I shuffle, I can shuffle. And I can shuffle and talk at the same time. I can shuffle, 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 and talk. I can cut the cards sometimes with one hand. I used to practice that when I was a kid. Dealing, a lot of people have trouble with dealing. They have to go 1, 1, 1, 1, 2, 2, 2, 2, 3, 3, 3. I can deal and I can talk and have a conversation. I can talk about numbers. I can do anything because dealing for me is automatic. That's a procedure. So that's what procedural memory is. So let's talk about images. Does our brain store pictures? There are people who will claim that they have a perfect visual image of something and they can see it in their mind's eye. They can actually see it inside their head. Do we store those images? Well, turns out the answer is a little complicated. It's a little yes, it's a little no. One of the things that I can tell you is I can force you to believe that you can remember an image. So let's go back. All of you who are watching this now, live or later or 4 a.m. or whenever you watch this, what I want you to do is close your eyes and remember your 12th birthday party. Your 12th birthday, did you have a party? Did you go someplace? What I want you to do is really think about what you did for your 12th birthday. And I want you to see if you can construct or if there's a visual image of anything that happened to you on your 12th birthday. I, for example, remember that I went to Disneyland on my 12th birthday and I took my best friend to Disneyland, and I can visually remember looking at, I forget what, the Matterhorn, I think it was. It was the only roller coaster back then, and being scared to death, and my friend wanted to go on the roller coaster, and he goaded me into it, and I can just see his face going, "You baby, you really, really should go, you baby." And I can hear him, I can almost hear his voice talking to me, I can see him, I can see the whole thing, I can see lining up, I can feel my heart. None of that's true. Never happened. Never happened. I asked him later, did it happen? He said, it never happened. You told me you didn't like roller coasters, so we didn't go. We went on It's a Small World instead, or something silly like that. And so how is it that I have such a clear visual image of this? And the answer is that most visual images are reconstructed from words. Somehow in my brain, I have, over time, spoken words inside my head about this horrific, scary roller coaster thing that happened to me at 12 years old, and basically convinced my brain with words that it's true. And so when my brain says, 12 years old, roller coaster, I go in, take those words out of my brain, visually reconstruct a picture of what must have been. I wonder if I put a beard on myself at 12. Probably not. Reconstruct all of that stuff, and then it feels real. It feels visual. It's not. It's all reconstructive memory. But interestingly enough, we are able to remember pictures. And this study I want to talk about is the only study, well, there's two studies that I want to talk about. Only two studies that really convinced me that there are pictures in our brain. So this is done by Shepard, the same Roger Shepard, who was a famous psychologist. Sam Shepard of Atkinson Shepard model, and Jackie Metzler, who was one of his graduate students. What they would do is they would show the person this. This has no meaning at all. It's just a figure. They would show the picture. They would put this out on the screen for a little while, sometimes 10 seconds, sometimes 30 seconds. Then they would take it off and they would show this. And they would say, is that exactly the same picture? So first you see this one, give yourself time to look at it. They would call it encode it in your brain. And then they would take away this picture and show you this and say, is that the same? Is it the same? Well, if you take this one, if you had them both in front of you and you took this one and rotate it a little bit clockwise, it ends up being exactly the same as this. How about this one? If they showed you this picture for a while and then showed you this, is it the same picture? Can you rotate it into the same thing? The answer is no. So if you have a mental picture, then what they predicted is the farther you had to rotate in order to get your mental image of this one to match or not match this one, the farther you had to rotate, the longer it would take. And here's the data. This is how far you had to rotate from 0 to 180 degrees. The reason they did it only to 180 degrees, not 360, is because people would rotate this way clockwise or this way counterclockwise, and that's 180 either way. If your chance, the amount of time it would take you to say same or different depended totally on how far you had to mentally rotate it. So the only way that could have happened is if you actually encoded this in your brain as a picture. Because there's no way you can describe it. How would you describe that? Well, there's three blocks coming straight out and then two down and four to the side and two, three down, and you can't, there's no way to describe that at all. So there must be mental pictures of this. Oops, let's go back. The other study is one done by George Sperling, and I don't have a slide on this because it's such a simple experiment. What Sperling did is he went in, and I think this happened in the early 70s somewhere, because it's when they were studying all this stuff at the same time. What he would do is sit a whole bunch of people down in a room and have a slide projector and a screen at the other side. And he would take and show usually 200 to 250 slides. One, the next, the next, the next. He would leave them on for a second or two, depending upon his the various study. There was sometimes a couple seconds, sometimes longer, sometimes shorter. Slide, 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 till he was all done. So let's say he showed you 200 slides. Then what he would do is set up a carousel with 400 slides, 200 that you saw, 200 that you didn't see, mixed up completely, and then he would show you one, and your job was to push a button, yes, I saw this before, or no, I didn't see this before. That's a really hard task, because most of the pictures he would show you for a second or two. So how do you think people did? The average person in Sperling's study got about 90% right. 90% of the time they were able to say, I saw it, or I didn't see it, and they were correct. The only way to do that with 200 pictures flashing at you, picture, 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 is to be able to encode some sort of visual image of that picture in your head. Where it's encoded, nobody knows. Carl Prebram thought it had to do with holograms stored in our head, that we had all these little holograms in our head that we stored pictures. The upshot is, yes, we may store pictures, but most pictures are reconstructed. They are reconstructed from language, because our brain is primarily language-based. If there are any pictures stored in our brain, it's almost accidental. So another model, I'm working my way to what I think is the best model, is called Baddeley's Working Memory Theory. Alan Baddeley was a British psychologist. I think he's passed away. He put this model together that said that we first have this thing called a central executive. That's like our controller. It's like a little man inside of our head or a little woman inside of our head that goes around and helps us remember things. And he have two things, one called the phonological, there's a little L at the end here that's missing, phonological loop, and the visuospatial sketchpad. I hate both of those terms. Phonological loop is sounds, it's sounds of words. If I read words to you out loud, they would be in your phonological loop. If I showed you them visually, they would be in your visuospatial sketchpad. It's even hard to say that. And the idea is the arrows go both ways, meaning the central executive pulls stuff in visually into the executive to work on it, and it pushes stuff out from the executive back into the sketchpad to store it in the sketchpad. Same thing with the phonological loop. Baddeley's model was not all that popular, ended up being pushed into a new model, which I think is the model that is probably the most important, and I want to spend some time on. The model has various names. It's either called the network association model, or sometimes called the spreading activation model. It has a variety of names, sometimes called the computer model. because it looks so much like a computer. It's based on the idea that there really isn't a box called short-term memory. There isn't a box called long-term memory. There's just one big, huge area in our brain called working memory. Now, I'm telling you right now that I just lied to you, because it's not in our brain. It's working memory is something different in our brain. But just imagine that your brain is just one whole thing. So it's one whole thing. People call it working memory. It's just one whole thing. And what there are in our brain are what are called nodes and links. A node is a concept. So for example, let's see if I have this next. Apple. Apple is a node. Apple, though, is meaningless without links. We have no intuitive, implicit idea when we're born of what an apple is. How do we learn what an apple is? Well, we learn that it's a fruit. And we learn that it can be red. We learn that it's probably sweet. We learn that it's crunchy. Those links to apple are what define apple. If you mostly eat green apples, then you're going to have a link from apple to green. These are my links, and I'll tell you how you figure out what your links are. Notice that some of the arrows are thicker and some are thinner. Thicker ones are more connected, meaning this node of fruit is more connected to apple. And the way I would know that, by the way, is I might do a free association task like Sigmund Freud, and I'd say, okay, tell me everything that you think when you hear the word apple. And this is what you see on the screen is what I said. The first thing that came out was fruit. Excuse me. First thing that came out was fruit. And so it has the thickest link between the node of apple and the node of fruit. The next thing that came out was red. The next thing that came out was sweet, then crunchy. And for me, because I did this a long time ago, iPod came out. Notice it's a very thin link because it was last. Now, this is a very simplistic way of doing this. If I asked all of you to free associate to apple, and you might try this with a friend, tell them you want to free associate and tell them you want them to write down every word they think of when they think of the word apple. The way they see it on the screen, like you see it on the screen, is going to be different from yours. In fact, every single person in the world has a different version because everybody's node of apple is different. You might get some employee of Apple Computer, and all of their links to Apple might have to do with computers or smartphones or iPhones or whatever. You might find somebody who grows apples, and theirs would be very different. Theirs would be links to specific kinds of apples. I don't even remember what kind of apples are there. Red Delicious apples or something. They might link Red Delicious apples. They might link Macintosh apples. Oh, wait, Macintosh is also one of those things for Apple developers, too. So anyway, this is just part of the story, because now let's imagine that we have my concept of apples, but when I hear the word apple and immediately think of fruit, then all of a sudden I think of orange. And when I think of orange, I think of orange peel. And when I think of orange, I also might think of tangerines. And then I might think of, they're all fruits. So what you have basically is a brain that has a whole bunch of these associative networks. That's why it's called the associative network model. These things right here are networks, and they're connected by associations. Now, what's interesting is I've made it very simplistic, because all of these are interconnected too. Everything is interconnected. And what controls the whole process is, first and foremost, our executive. And what that means is the front of our brain is called the prefrontal cortex. We might get to this today, although maybe not. We have about 10 minutes left, and we'll see if I get to it. Front of our brain is called our prefrontal cortex. This is our executive. This is our controller. This is that Battley's boss that's in the middle of our brain telling it what to do. You can think of it as a person with arms grabbing things from here, grabbing things from here, grabbing things from here, putting these together, throwing things away that are useless. The second issue is what's called dimming activation. So if I say the word apple, I activate that whole network that I showed you with apple. So when I say the word apple, I'm going to activate the word fruit and then the word crunchy or red or whatever activate my network, but it doesn't stay there. You can think of it as, I've seen people actually refer to this by lights. They take each node and they put lights there and they put the links with lights. So imagine the link between apple and red, we'll say, is a link. And when I think of apple, I think of red, but then I go off and think about other things and that link starts to dim. Now, if I come back and think about apples again, that link then brightens up again. But then as I stop thinking about apples, it dims and eventually it goes away. Which, by the way, we're going to talk a lot about in terms of how you, what happens when you are working on one task and you switch to another. So let me give you an example. Suppose that you were working on your reaction paper for this class and you did question one, telling us which questions you picked, and you started to do question two, and all of a sudden you got distracted because you got a text message. So again, peer inside your brain. So inside your brain, there's a whole network there that's dealing with question two. But you go deal with the text message and you tap and you deal with the text message and you come back and the depending upon how long you've been gone, the material for question two has now either dimmed or it's gone and you have to reactivate it all. And so what happens, and we'll talk about this a lot when I talk about multitasking in a couple of weeks, that this is why multitasking doesn't work and why if you try to switch from one task to the next and then back and forth and back and forth, it ends up taking you longer to do it than if you did both tasks one at a time. First do this whole task, keep the whole section in your brain activated all at once, then stop that task, finish, now do this task, keep your brain activated, don't get distracted at all. This is why distraction is so dangerous in your brain. So then the question is this neurological? Is it biochemical? And the answer is yes. It is neurological, it is biochemical, it is electrical, and we can measure it in a variety of ways, which I'm going to show you a lot this semester because we do some of these measurements, and other people do too. One of the things that we can learn is pathological brains can tell us a lot about how our brains work. So this is going, I'm going to play you a trailer from the movie Avatar. And what I want you to notice is, it's a short trailer, it's a couple minutes. This is a male, 20 to 25 years old, who's watching this. He's inside of an MRI scanner. So what we're going to see is colors on his brain. This is a side view of his brain, there's his nose, this is a top view of his brain. And what you're going to see is colors reflecting the activity in his brain. I will tell you that the activity is actually blood flow and oxygen and glucose, and the darker the color, in this case the more orange and red it is, the more blood flow to that area. So pay particular attention to this area here that's called personal meaning, and this area, that's the, as I'll tell you later, that's the amygdala, the seat of emotions, and this area right up in front, that frontal part, the front of your cortex, and then also auditory. Whenever there's loud sounds, you'll see the auditory cortex. If there's interesting visual images, you'll see the visual cortex lit up. You'll see the visual cortex on this side also. So can we go ahead and play this one?
Thank you.
Oh, I hope that you noticed a bunch of things on there. One, I hope, and you can watch this as many times as you like, by the way. This is done by a company in San Diego called MindSign Online, and they do this for movie companies. The company sends them multiple copies of a trailer, and they show it to people, put them in an MRI tube, see which one lights up their brain more. You sort of see that this guy, this 20 to 25-year-old male, you saw a lot of orange around here, the auditory and visual stuff. You saw a lot up here, the attention, a lot of paying attention, particularly when something novel happened. You saw some personal meaning in here, but you really see a lot. I'm going to skip Obama's speech. You can watch this later. The blue is also an indication, but it's a long one. But I want to show you another one now that you know what you're looking for. This is one of the trailers for the Harry Potter movie. So can we show this one? And then I think we'll come back and we'll pretty much be done for the day.
This place is known magic. Very dark. Very powerful. This time, I cannot hope to destroy it alone.
Times like these, dark times, it can bring people together.
Take my hand.
And they can tear them apart.
These girls, they're gonna kill me, Harry.
This year,
Voldemort has chosen Draco Malfoy for a mission.
They're truly horrific. Now I know you will see worse. You're the chosen one, Harry.
You have to realize who you are.
Without you, we'd leave the fate of our world to chance. You have no choice. You must not fail.
So I never saw that movie, but I can tell you from the trailer that I learned several things. First of all, anybody who tries to convince you that we only use 10% of our brain at any time, just show them the movie, because it's very clear that we're using all of our brain all of the time. The other thing is to notice that that was a very visual movie trailer. The sounds, there was music behind it certainly, but the music was less important than it was in Avatar. And so you'll notice that there was a lot more activity with the visual cortex. This guy was a Harry Potter fan, so it was a lot more personal meaning in there, a lot more executive function work. There's four videos on Blackboard, Avatar, a speech by President Obama, the trailer for Up, and the trailer for Harry Potter. I encourage you to look at them and get an idea of how our brain actually works. It's a fascinating device, and we'll talk more about this on Thursday. Have a great day.